What we've tried to recreate in the display of Michael Wellby's collection is an evocation of a continental Kunstkammer or treasure chamber. Continental Kunstkammers contained man-made objects and natural objects, and often the two concepts were combined together. So this owl is made from a carved coconut. It's been cleverly carved with feathers. It's also extraordinarily so quirky and really quite amusing. Its wings open, the head comes off, and it will be filled with wine or beer, and you could pour it into the smaller head and use this as a drinking cup.
This is a tankard, a beer tankard of relatively ordinary form, made by a man called Moritz Kaltschmidt. And round the tankard have been applied a series of figures which represent the seven planetary deities: the Moon, Saturn, Jupiter, Mars, the Sun, Venus, and Mercury.
This is a very fine 17th century tobacco box. And what's remarkable about this object is how it was made. If you look at these wonderful scenes, these very, very deeply modelled scenes, if you look on the inside, you can see how the decoration on the outside mirrors what's on the inside. And this was done by bashing the silver onto the flat sheet of silver onto a soft bed of pitch, black pitch, which would have been on a special workbench, and hammering the silver into the pitch to create this very deeply modelled 3D decoration, and then chasing it from the front with this chisel-like tools to sharpen up all this decoration. It's incredibly involved and skillful work, but incredibly effective.
This is a nautilus shell, the shell of a marine cephalopod from the South China Sea. These were treasured in European collections from the Middle Ages onwards. But this one, which is mounted in silver gilt with Neptune on the top, and Neptune is riding this wonderfully fierce, sharp-toothed sea monster. But what is really special about this one is the fact that the decoration on the sides was executed in the Far East before the nautilus shell was imported into Europe.
This is an early 17th century pomander, made in about 1620, something like that, and it's made from silver, and then it's been engraved on the surface with exotic flowers and parrots playing among the flowers. And then the background has been filled with black mastic, which is a kind of gum imported from the Mediterranean. This opens rather like an orange when you unscrew it to reveal these little individual segments. And they have little sliding compartments which will contain different spices.
This is what art historians call a memento mori, a reminder that you must die. So here is the head of the dead individual with a headband with an inscription about the misery of human life in German, but turn him round and you see the later phase of the fate of the human body in physical decay.
This is a little drinking cup, and it's beautifully decorated and then partially gilded with scrolling floral ornament and little flowers and these sort of cartouches of scroll work. And this style of decoration was brought into Moscow, where this was made, in the 1660s by Greek emigre jewellers who'd been brought into the city. It's a drinking cup, and if you turn it upside down, there's an inscription in Cyrillic which says, "He who drinks from me once is a happy man, but he who drinks from me twice is a fool." It has a sort of separate lid which comes off, but rather peculiarly, it's got this little pear-shaped finial on the top, which when you unscrew it, actually opens out to reveal little segments like an orange with individual compartments. And I think these would have contained spices. And it's either a pomander for smelling, or I think possibly what happened is you could dip it upside down into your wine or beer and spice the wine. I suspect that's what it's for.
This cup, silver gilt, was made in Nuremberg about 1570 by one of the most remarkable, imaginative and virtuoso goldsmiths of the European Renaissance, Wenzel Jamnitzer. It has, as you can see, tiny little creatures up the cup and little snakes around the foot. It was one of the objects that Michael Wellby was most proud of in his collection because he appreciated what an extraordinary feat of technical virtuosity this casting is.
The Wellby collection also contains a huge number of spoons, spoons made from the 14th right through to the 19th centuries. This is a particularly fine example. This was made in Germany, probably in Nuremberg, around about 1600. And it's rather cleverly decorated, very elaborately decorated, with grotesque faces and strap work. And then on the back of the stem here, there's a tiny, tiny figure of St. George killing the dragon. And then on the end of the pommel here, there's a tiny figure of the kneeling princess who's being rescued by St. George. Now this is a folding spoon, actually. You can see it folds like this. And would have been carried in a little leather case with you when you were travelling around. At this time, people carried their own personal cutlery with them. It rather cleverly turns into a fork when you take the spoon bowl off like this and you lock the fork into place. It's also rather cleverly, rather like a Swiss army knife, unscrews at the end to reveal a little pen. And then inside the pen is hidden a little toothpick and a little ear scoop, which have been used for your personal sort of grooming at the same time.
This jug is a pottery jug of what is called fritware, made in Turkey, in Ottoman Turkey, at Iznik. But what is remarkable about this example is that it is in a London-made silver gilt mount of 1607. So we know that this piece of Iznik pottery was imported into Elizabethan London, or just into Jacobean London, and in the year 1607 was mounted up by a London goldsmith as a precious and exotic example of pottery from across the world.
This little casket, beautifully engraved with biblical scenes all around it. It's actually a marriage casket and would have been given by a young man to his to a young lady when he proposed to her. And actually, if she accepted this, and it contained usually some coins or a specially minted marriage medal, that was seen as the sign of engagement. It's beautifully engraved with these scenes taken from the Old Testament. On the top here we have Lot with his daughters, and then here we have Susanna on the front of the elders. It has a lovely little gilded lock and opens to reveal a plain interior which would have contained the money or the specially minted coins. This cup is a triumph of virtuoso goldsmith's technique. It's nearly made entirely from embossing and chasing. So although these 3D figures may look like they're cast, or they're actually made from a flat piece of silver, which has been hammered, deeply hammered out to create this 3D figure playing a lute on the lid.
Perhaps the most spectacular and extraordinary single object in Michael's collection, as well as one of the very rarest, is this enormous, monumental, extravagant Portuguese silver gilt ewer, made perhaps in Lisbon about 1520. It is a most extraordinary amalgam of flamboyant styles and one of the most splendid pieces of Manueline art that has come down to us.
This mother-of-pearl plaque has a pair, there are two of them together, and when Michael Wellby bought it with its pair about 30 years ago at auction, all this mother-of-pearl and this silver gilt work was thought to be mid-19th century. But Michael was convinced, and we're convinced here too, that actually the whole thing was put together in about 1720, 1730, and that all this wonderful beautifully carved mother of pearl work, and these very detailed silver gilt mounts were made in Augsburg in around about that time. And if you look at them quite closely, you'll see that they have quite a strong iconography. You've got the battle scenes going on here, and then the silver gilt mounts all around here are quite specific. They show trophies of Eastern arms, and these arms, I think, are Turkish arms. And then the figure here, she's holding a kind of flail in her hand. She and there's a small child holding a palm of victory and beating a drum. He's a figure of victory. And I think what these plaques are celebrating is the Austrian victory over the Ottoman Empire